as the children, you and family. You and our children international serve more than 2,300 children and youth in Central Arkansas. Reverend Davis studied American Studies and lived at Lake Forest College, Lake Forest, Illinois. He also studied African American Studies at the University of Wisconsin in Madison, Wisconsin. He is a native of Little Rock, and he is grateful of the community he's made and proud father of the lady who leads, Sarah L. Davis, and Eleanor Davis. So without further ado, let me go ahead and bring up Mr. Ryan Davis. Thank you.
Hey, my brother. stop. There won't be no games tonight. I got it. I was like, oh, this is okay. There's other people coming that speak good for you. He never did. But I came up with that choice when folks my age were intent on busting the prison doors wide open and people were being sent to jail and left right and center. And so I think we need to recognize how far we've come. The young men these days are more responsible. They graduate from high school, matriculate into college at higher levels than we've ever seen.
Right.
Huh? All right. They participate in community activities at higher levels than we've ever seen. Our youth organizations have waiting lists. So I think we got to stop operating in bad conditions. And not to say that we need to, but we need to stop operating that. I'm going all the way off script, so let me get back on track. I have only three pieces to share with you. If you can bear with me for about, I said 15, maybe 17. 17 minutes. No time. I'm going to get a general idea in mind. 17 minutes. Let me share this with you. There's a poem I love to kind of begin with all the time. And this poem comes from a great preacher and scholar, Reverend Dr. Benjamin Elijah Mays. Reverend Dr. Benjamin Elijah Mays was long-time president of Morehouse College, was a scholar, one of America's great preachers, and a mentor to folks like Martin Luther King, Andrew Young, and a lot of other folks. First black person to be elected to the school board in the city of Atlanta, but really in his heart, a really, really great teacher. Somebody who understood what it meant, not just to proclaim the word of the people, but to teach people about what does say the word. He said this poem to his students at chapel every Tuesday. When the students were required to come to chapel, he said this poem to them. It goes like this, easy to remember, young man. I have only just a minute, only 60 seconds in it. Forced upon me, I can't refuse it. I didn't see it, and I didn't choose it. The time that we have on you from this earth. What a profound expression of how minutes roll into hours, hours into days. And so we have to always be sure that we're adding another with our minutes, right? That we're using our minutes to, hey, man, I know we got to use some of those minutes to sleep. We got to use some of those minutes to eat. We have to use some of those minutes to laugh. We have to use some of those minutes to mourn. But outside of those very necessary parts of life, we have to ask ourselves on this regular, a moment as possible, what am I doing with the minutes of my life? What am I doing for other folks who live with their backs against the wall with the minutes of my life? I love that one. Pardon me. We only have a minute. And every minute lost is gone forever. Part two. I love a good acronym. Right? You know, a word that means something about what it means. One of my favorite is the acronym PUSH. PUSH. PUSH because, you know, we have to push against all those things that would deny us justice. We have to push against all those things which would deny us humanity. And we have to push against all those things that would have us sit back and be lazy when the time of power was in the earth. PUSH, the P stands for perseverance. I love this. And I think one of the greatest exemplars of perseverance is Dr. George Washington Carver, right? I know most of what we know about George Washington Carver has to do with peanut, all the products he made with peanut, but I think that George Washington Carver's exemplary perseverance is something that we also look at more closely. You talk about a man who was born in slavery, born slave. Well, I don't think anybody was born slave, born a human, you just enslaved. He was born an enslaved person. And this is somebody who got accepted to a college in Iowa, hitched a ride all the way from Missouri into Iowa, only to be told about it. This is before they sent pictures of the applications. And was told at Hamlin College, oh, we thought you were white. We're going to deny you this. So what did George Washington Carver do? He didn't give up because he had perseverance. Remember, we talked about PUSH, the P is for perseverance. And so he decided, well, I'm going to start taking in laundry. I'm going to start They didn't accept me here. I'm just going to pass down my bucket and try to get out of it. But he never gave up. Never gave up. He did give up on farmers in Alabama when they insisted we have to go cotton. Cotton is king. It's the only thing that's popular. And he was telling them all the time, you need to nourish your land. If you plant beans, if you plant peanuts, they give nutrients to the land. He died of nutrients, but he never gave up. So two things there. He was persevering because he did give up on himself, and he did give up on his people. The UN push stands for urgency. So we have perseverance and urgency. Amen. The time Dr. King says is always right because we was right. So the time was quoted that he said, and the time is right now. Urgency. When I think of urgency, I think of an illiterate or semi-illiterate sharecropper from Sunflower County, Mississippi, by the name of Fannie Lou Hamer. A woman who could have just also given up on life. A woman whose father lost his family because he said, one day I'm not going to be a sharecropper. And when I'm not a sharecropper, I'm going to own my own kids, my own cows, my own chickens. Only to have some folks who did believe a black man should have that stuff come to his barn and burn it and all of his apples out of business. Fannie Lou Hamer probably had a right to do it. Probably had a right to live in circumstances to say, you know, there's nothing we can do down here. We can't get past it. But what did she do instead? She decided at the age of 23 years old that she was going to register to vote. The boss said, we're going to get y'all out of here. She did so anyway. The police took off the bus to meet her. She eventually died from that being 2 decades later from complications from that, but she still never gave up. You think about somebody who went from an semi-literate sharecropping woman in a time where nobody valued anything about her, and she goes on to be a co-founder of the Freedom Democratic Party in Mississippi. A woman whose voice was so powerful that Lyndon Johnson cut in with a presidential message when she tried to address the nation. A woman who went on from founding the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party to go back to her community, she could have gone to some fellowship in D.C., or she could have gone to some fancy office position based off of her fame, but she decided to go back to Mississippi. To where Indian Oval, I've never heard of today. You talk about Indian Oval to Mississippi.
No.
There we go. Yeah. And she founded the Freedom Farmers Collective. Because she understood that if we want to own ourselves, we have to own our own property. If we want to own our futures, then we have to show our children what it means to have some ownership. Yes. And she felt like the time was always right to push that message forward. Fannie Lou Hamer, brothers, is an example of urgency. Perseverance, urgency, scholarship. Now, this kind of scholarship I'm talking about is a verb and an adjective, not a noun, right? We know the noun scholarship is what somebody hands to you because you did some great work in school, but I expect all these young men in here are on their road to scholarship eligibility. But we're not talking about that noun scholarship, not quite. We're talking about the kind of scholarship. You know what I love when Jesus was asked, what's the most important thing? And he said that you should love the Lord your God with your heart, soul, with all your heart, soul, and mind. And your mind. I think we forget that sometimes. We don't really put the emphasis on the fact that Jesus said that love God with your mind. A great theologian from the state of Arkansas by the name of James Conner said that theology is loving God with your mind. That Bible study is loving God with your mind. That having questions, I tell my students at church and Sunday school, is loving God with your mind. W.E.B. Du Bois, probably the greatest exemplar of scholarship in Americans, not black Americans, not 20th century Americans, but Americans, because he's recognized that there's value in being curious. I tell my students, my work study students at the university all the time, that if you have a phone in your hand, you have an
possibly ask.
We live in an age when information is no farther than wherever your phone is. For 100 people, it's in their hands, so like this. And it's not. I'm actually surprised. I'm not surprised. I don't want to say that. I'm trying to talk about it. Whenever I'm talking to young folks, I have people with phones. And so I really appreciate that I'm not people with phones.
Yes, sir.
But then you get boys who lived in an age where his life wasn't valued, his scholarship wasn't valued, and he didn't have a home that was rich, exemplified scholarship. Scholarship is really just curiosity. Wanting to know the answer to the next question. Right. Wanting to know the great why. Right? Funny story, W.E.B. Du Bois was honored with an alumni award from Harvard College. He was the first black man to receive a PhD from Harvard College. And someone interviewed him afterwards said, Dr. Du Bois, what an honor it must have been for you to be a student at Harvard. And Du Bois, nonetheless, turned around and said, the honor, I assure you, was Harvard's. Patricia old man with the German beard and funny beginning of accent, the honor was not his, the honor was Harvard's. Loving God with your mind. Understanding that any question you have deserves to be answered. Right? If nobody questioned their chains, we would still be enslaved. If nobody questioned their parameters, we still wouldn't have the right to vote. If nobody questioned the back of us, we still would be standing back. Scholarship. It's not just something done in the high and power places. Don't go there. You can come to those places. You deserve to be there. Scholarship happens right on the corner. The last in our push has to be perseverance, urgency, scholarship, and honor. My grandfather. We all had two of them. Some of us are fortunate enough to have grandfathers and unbiological. One of my grandfathers, Reverend Dr. Levi Gordon Davis, was his first assignment a principal at Wilson Trade School of Mississippi County, Arkansas. And they used to come, this is in 1952, they used to come and they'd take the books from the white school and they'd dump them from the back of their truck on the lawn at the beginning of the school. And my grandma said, well, you know, the dudes with the grass is pushed I prefer to come big money. And they didn't like it, that he felt too good for new way books. And so Grandpa said he wanted to quit that day, but if he wanted to come, he's committed to those people. Now this is a man who's going out to school in Michigan State, had tasted an integrated society, left 8 million, went to Michigan State, tasted an integrated society, studied at the University of Chicago, had a taste of freedom, but was honorable to his community. And I wish I had this much of it. I'm working on it. And God is working with me. But honor means just that. Honoring our community. My favorite, one of my favorite pieces of scripture comes from 2 Kings chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. And I'm going to paraphrase. It's about the flowing basket. Right? Now, most of the time I hear that story, I hear about the miracle of God making an ass head flow. That'll make a shout like this. God can create a miracle out of any situation. As heavy as an ass head is, it should flow, but God made it so. It speaks to the power of God. But then I got a second understanding of that, and let me paraphrase. So one of the disciples of the prophet Elisha, 2 Kings chapter 6, verses 1 to 7, says to him that our place is too small. Let's go to the Jordan River, and each of us is going to cut down a log, and we're going to build a bigger place for us to live and for us to study. Then they said, teacher, Elisha, won't you come with us? And he said, I'll go, so he went with them. And as they were cutting down the trees, one of the men, dropped his axe head into the water. And he cried out, oh no, alas, my axe was borrowed. Great trepidation, because not only did he drop his axe, but it wasn't even his. And the man of God, Elijah, showing Elijah caught a piece of wood going in the water and made the axe head for him. Elijah said, pick it up, and so he did. And the story goes on from there. In this illustration, we see a community of faithful people. I want you to know that this story comes at. At this time, there was famine and there was war. But these people still had the presence of mind in that dire situation to say, hey, even now, we need to be building for the kingdom. Right? In the middle of war, in the middle of famine, they had the presence of mind to expand and build for the kingdom. Even folks who didn't have an axe, in the case of this man, everybody knew that they had a responsibility. Every man knew that they had to go out there and chop down one tree. And this man said, even if I have to go borrow an axe, I'm going out there and I'm going to chop down one tree. Every man here has a tree chopped down in our community. Every man here has a contribution of it. Every man and young man here should push against those bad expectations and those bad conditions. Every man here should understand that our minutes are precious. Everybody contributes. Everybody understands that we all have a part to play. We all